A point estimate provides a single plausible value for a parameter. However, a point estimate is rarely perfect. Usually there is some error in the estimate. To account for this error, we provide a plausible range of values for the parameter. This video accompanies the discussion of confidence intervals in open interest statistics. We will introduce an approximate 95% confidence interval and consider a sampling distribution for the mean. Then we will learn about changing the confidence level and make sure we are interpreting confidence intervals exactly as we should be. A single point estimate, like the sample mean, will likely not be equal to the exact population parameter, like the true population mean. On the other hand, if we report a range of plausible values, we have a good shot at capturing the population parameter. A plausible range of values for the population parameter is called a confidence interval. The standard error is a measure of uncertainty associated with a point estimate and provides a guide for how large we should make the confidence interval. The standard error represents the standard deviation associated with the estimate. If the interval spreads out two standard errors from the point estimate, we can be roughly 95% confident that we have captured the true parameter value. But what does 95% confident mean? Suppose we took many samples and built a 95% confidence interval from each sample. Then about 95% of those intervals would contain the actual mean. To generate this figure, 25 samples of size 100 were taken from a population of running times for a 10-mile race in Washington, D.C. For each sample, a point estimate and confidence interval were calculated to create a plausible range of values for the population mean. Only one of these 25 intervals did not capture the true mean of 94.52 minutes. In other words, 24 out of the 25 intervals did capture the true mean, or 96% of the intervals. Let's take 100,000 samples, calculate the mean of each, and plot them in a histogram to get an especially accurate depiction of the sampling distribution. The left panel shows a histogram of the sample means for 100,000 different random samples. The right panel shows a normal probability plot of those sample means. Both plots show that the collection of sample means follow a normal model. This result can be explained by the central limit theorem. Informally, we can describe the central limit theorem as follows. If a sample consists of at least 30 independent observations and the data are not strongly skewed, then the distribution of the sample mean is well approximated by a normal model. Suppose we want to consider confidence intervals where the confidence level is somewhat higher than 95%. Perhaps we would like a confidence interval of 99%. To create a 99% confidence level, we must widen our 95% interval. On the other hand, if we want an interval with a lower confidence, such as 90%, we could make our original 95% interval slimmer. The 95% confidence interval structure provides guidance on how to make intervals with new confidence levels. There are three components to this interval: the point estimate, 1.96, and the standard error. The choice of 1.96 times the standard error is based on the point estimate being nearly normal. It's close to 2, like the confidence interval we used earlier, but it's a little more precise. To create a 99% confidence interval, change 1.96 to 2.58. This number comes from the normal distribution. If we looked at the normal distribution, going 2.58 standard deviations in either direction would capture 99% of all observations. Throughout our discussion of confidence intervals, we have been relying on a few important conditions to ensure the sampling distribution of the sample average is nearly normal and the estimate of the standard error is sufficiently accurate. First, we require the sample observations to be independent. Usually, subjects are considered independent if they undergo random assignment in an experiment, or if they are obtained by a simple random sample consisting of less than 10% of the population. Second, we require that the sample size is large. 30 is often used as a rule of thumb. Finally, it is important that the distribution of sample observations is not strongly skewed. A careful eye might have observed the somewhat awkward language used to describe confidence intervals. The correct interpretation is that we are some percent confident that the population parameter is between the lower bound and upper bound of our confidence interval. Incorrect language might try to describe the confidence interval as capturing the population parameter with a certain probability. This is one of the most common errors. While it might be useful to think of it as a probability, the confidence level only quantifies how plausible it is that the parameter value is in the interval. Another especially important consideration is that the confidence intervals only try to capture the population parameter. A confidence interval says nothing about the confidence of capturing individual observations, a proportion of observations, or about capturing point estimates. This video introduced us to confidence intervals. Along the way, we saw how to adjust our calculations to achieve different levels of confidence and interpret confidence intervals correctly. If you learned something you found interesting, share this video with a friend and visit openintro.org for more resources.